Okay, great. So I have started recording of the system of this particular session. This is just for your consent. Let us go topic by topic.
Lokendra, what is the main difference between architect and professional course that is reflecting on your site?
Okay. So that is really tricky question. What is the difference? So let me tell you, there are different profiles. Let me bring down the particular profiles here. So I'm going to tell you that what all certifications are available, right? Hello? So guys, these are the particular main courses a person can begin with, like fundamental, or you can call it foundational. So this course requires at least 6 months of industry knowledge. Then you can go for this, like AWS certified cloud practitioner. Then after, these are the particular courses which are of associate level, like AWS certified solution architect associate, like SysOps associate, and developer associate. These are the courses. Then when you begin with it, so from the side of, if you have completed your SysOps or you have completed your developer, then you can go for DevOps course into professional, or you can go for solution architect. So now what is the roles and responsibility do we have here? So guys, let me tell you, these guys like solution architects, SysOps and developers, these guys are supposed to like no basics and intermediate stuff. Let us say if someone is going to ask you, do you know how to create EC2 machine? So if you know that, it means you are responding as SysOps. But if you say that you know the features of EC2 machine, that why do we need to select which option, then you are going to be working as solution architect. So as per AWS policy, solution architects are not supposed to implement. But if you see the industry, so they are not looking for such a person who has knowledge of that what is what. They are looking for such candidates that they should not only be having knowledge about what is what, but they should be knowing that how to implement it, right? Moreover, they are looking for solution architect. They are looking for SysOps administrator as well. And like somehow or the other, they are looking for some part of developer as well. Because if you have to implement the particular CI/CD pipeline with your infrastructure, so that particular part has to be managed by your developers, because see, whenever it comes to pipeline writing, so that is completely like core development sort of area, and you have to be ready for it, right? So this becomes a complete combination of all these three. If you know all three, then you can be a DevOps, like implementation part, you know, development, you know, then you can become a like DevOps engineer. And if you have like moved yourself forward into like solutioning part only, let us say if someone is going to ask you that I have 1 million requests per second coming to your platform, right? So what sort of tools and how many number of servers, whether it is going to be vertical scaling, it is going to be horizontal scaling. So what sort of better approach you are going to follow? Then you are going to be a solution architect. When it comes to like associate and professional, so almost same tools are going to be repeated. But the difference here is, in professional level, you are not only going to manage these things from GUI panel, but definitely you will have to have understanding of CLI as well. Because if you have to automate something, then GUI does not allow you to automate it. Right?
Okay, great.
Now, we have some specialty courses as well. So like we have advanced networking, we have security, machine learning, Alexa Skill Builder, We have certified database administrator and we have certified database analytics as well. These are specialty courses. So if you would like to go, then definitely there are two, like you can go for AWS certified advanced networking specialty and you can go for AWS certified security specialty. Only these are the two certificates which we should opt for. Reason being, because we are not into machine learning, Alexa skilled builder, maybe data analytics. But yes, if someone is coming from DB background, so then definitely the person can go on to this particular platform, which is database specialty. You can directly opt for this particular certificate, like AWS Certified Solution Architect Professional, or maybe AWS Certified DevOps Engineer Professional. You can go for this sort of certificate directly. There is no need to go for these at like initial level. These certificates are going to cost you up to approximately $150 USD, like United States dollars you will have to pay with some taxes. So approximately in Indian currency, that will become somewhere 14,000 something, right? And over here, you will have to pay approximately $300. So that is how it works, right?
Yeah.
So what we are going to cover here, like we are going to cover this particular complete part. Moreover, like up to 50% of this, sorry. So up to 50% of this section, we are going to cover under this course, right? So now let us go to our section. Let us go to our server again website that we should understand that what are the things we are covering and what are the things we should know. So guys, I hope that we all are aware of that. What is cloud computing and what is AWS?
Yeah.
So what is cloud computing? Yes, guys, what is cloud computing?
It's basically an interface where all the cloud infra is available.
For what?
For like EC2 instances, database, network, security, means everything that should be required for data center, that all things are available via GUI.
Okay, great. Okay, so if I talk about like cloud service and deployment model, so are we aware of it? Like what are the default, what are the basic models do we have?
Yeah, right. Yesterday, as we discussed, it is IaaS.
We have the PaaS, we have the platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, software as a service.
Yes. So like how AWS is leader in the cloud domain. So we discussed about that particular part as well yesterday, right?
Yes.
Because up to 50% like stake even AWS is holding as of today in market, then it is a really big thing, right? Then yeah. After various cloud products offered by AWS, we discussed yesterday, like these were the services here, like it is going to provide you compute offering, different storage sections, different databases, multiple tools for migration and data transfer, networking and content delivery, developer tools we discussed about, robotics. In fact, we have here customer enablement, we have blockchain as well, satellite, quantum technologies, right? Management and government service AWS is going to provide, media services. Apart from this, we have machine learning. Then after we have analytics. So even if you want, you can have you can become a specialist in like analytics only, right? So you will have to read only these particular tools. Like how does AWS Glue work, data exchange, pipeline, QuickSight, Kinesis, Elasticsearch service, cloud search, EMR, like Elastic MapReduce, that is a particular part of Hadoop. So that can be integrated with Redshift because Redshift is a replacement of Hadoop. You can go for Athena. So Athena is going to be a particular tool. Let us say if you have data in terabytes in S3 and you have to run some SQL queries on the top of it, but that data should be structured, right? So if you have structured data stored in S3 bucket, then definitely you can run query on it with the help of Athena. Then you have security, multiple security stuff AWS is going to provide. Then after we are going to have here front end and web mobile application, AR and VR. Are we aware of AR and VR?
This is virtual reality.
And AR?
Augmented reality.
Yes, you are right. Application integration, cost management, customer engagement, business applications, end user computing, maybe IoT, then game development and containers. So these are the services which are available on platform of AWS. But yes, obviously I am telling you only the particular main headlines here. I am not going to talk about each and every individual service here. We will discuss later on whatever services are going to be covered in our course. We are going to discuss that, right? So whereas computing product offered by AWS, I have just explained to you. So these are going to be product only. Now the main components, what we are supposed to know here, these are going to be like introduction to AWS. The main services are going to be like, which are usually discussed during interview. So they are going to be such as S3, EC2, VPC, EBS, ELB, AMI. So these sort of component we are going to discuss. Okay, so when we are talking about these services, so what these services are, let me walk you through that. So when we talk about EC2, so EC2 is going to be a virtual server in cloud. Virtual server in the cloud, that is known as EC2. C2 is not a fancy name. We will discuss whenever we will start working with EC2 machine. We will start working with this as well. So this is under compute section. Let us say if you have to create a server inside cloud, then you will opt this option. There are different options available like LightSail, Lambda, Batch, Elastic Beanstalk, Serverless Application Repository, Outpost, EC2 Image Builder and all. So we are going to discuss about these sort of components as well, but majorly we are going to discuss about EC2, right? If we talk about storage, so we have different options available. Like we have S3, so that is known as simple storage service. So scalable storage in cloud. So we will have to understand that what are the options available here? How do we work with it? How do we upload data here? What are the particular tactics we use in order to upload data? What are the like charges model do we have here? How many type of storage does S3 provide, right? EFS, like centralized managed NFS storage we can have here, that sort of thing. Different databases we have. Manage data, manage and transfer, like AWS migration and how we are going to like simply migrate your on-prem data center to AWS. Application discovery, how you are going to create an inventory of applications which are running in your on-prem data center, right? Because we are not only going to migrate the applications, but we will have to understand that if we are migrating ABC application, that what all dependencies are there, right? Then after we have DMS, like database migration services. So let us say if you are running a particular database in any physical server and you want to migrate that to RDS, like this one component, relational database services, that is managed database. So if you want to migrate from physical server to RDS, then definitely this particular service can be used here. We have migration like services, server migration services like lift and shift, you can do it, right? Then after transfer family, so like let us say if you are running FTP, SFTP, FTPS, fine. So if you want to migrate your on-prem, these sort of services like FTP, FTPS or SFTP, then you can easily migrate it from on-prem to cloud computing. If you have really big chunk of data, let us say data in what are the units of data? If I ask you what are the units of data? Yes, guys, who is going to answer that question? What are the units of data?
It has segregated into the blocks, you mean to say, right?
Okay, like bit, byte and all.
Yes, yes. Right.
Bit, byte, KB and MB. Anyone who is going to tell me all?
MB, GB, terabyte.
Okay, let us type in here. Let us see the particular scale. First of all, it is bit. Then after?
Byte.
Then?
KB, MB, GB, TB.
GB after?
TB. Petabyte. The yottabyte. And Z, I think I know that's a zettabyte, something like that.
Exabyte. So up to this much data storage is available on the platform of AWS up to EB.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And every single unit has to be multiplied by 1024. Only then next unit comes, right? So up to zettabyte, we have data storage available on AWS platform. And we have to be ready to understand these sort of things, right? So if we talk about AWS, so AWS is going to provide up to this much data, like data storage, and the particular solution name is here, that is known as your EFS, Elastic File System. By default, it is going to provide you 8 exabytes of storage.
Oh,
right. So that sort of thing, that sort of things are here. Okay, now let us try to understand like what is your VPC. So VPC is going to be your virtual private cloud. You can create your own isolated network segment in AWS data center. Right, then after you can have your EBS, like Elastic Block Storage. So block storage means there are two types of storage available, like first is object level storage and second one is going to be block level storage. We will discuss about the differences, like what is block level storage, what is object level storage and all. What is ELB? It means Elastic Load Balancer we are going to talk about. So what are the types of load balancer do we have? And the major question which usually people fail to answer, that is that in which particular use case we are going to select which type of load balancer, right? And what is AMI? People call that AMI as well, right? So that is AMI, it means Amazon Machine Image we are going to discuss, okay? So these are the components which we are going to discuss in very, very detail. So that's why I'm not going to discuss it here. Now, the very next point, what we need to discuss here, AWS architecture and AWS management console, virtualization AWS Xen versus Nitro Hypervisor. So any idea about like what is Xen, what is Nitro Hypervisor?
Xen is a hypervisor which is used by Linux. And,
okay, and what is Nitro Hypervisor?
I'm not sure, sir.
Okay, so let me ask you the very first question here. What is virtualization? What is virtualization, guys?
So virtualization is means so if you have one physical host, so if you want to do multiple creation of multiple server, so mm-hmm. we can do that. Yeah, so that is the benefit of the virtualization.
Okay, fine, great. So how does virtualization work? Who is going to answer that?
On the top of physical machine, one hypervisor need to be set up, and on top of that hypervisor, okay. we can.
Okay. Great. So the particular terms which you are going to speak while defining this thing, let us type in that hypervisor. Yes, hypervisor, then complete your definition.
On the level first, there will be one physical machine.
Okay, let us type in physical machine as well.
Physical machine, yeah.
That is known as host.
Host, yeah.
P-H-Y-S-I-C-A, physical machine.
Host. On the top.
A machine
of,
equal to server, right? Which is known as host.
Yeah.
Yes. Go
on
ahead.
On top of that physical machine, it will be hypervisor.
Okay.
And on top of hypervisor, by using the hypervisor functionality, we can host multiple sub servers, or you can say VMs. Depends on the availability of resources into host. Let's say if we have 6 GB RAM into physical machine, so okay. we can only create the virtual machines that all max will utilize 6 GB.
Okay, so Upender, how does hypervisor work?
Hypervisor use the resources of host machine and provide them to a virtual machine, guest machine.
No, I mean to ask that what is the functionality of hypervisor? Like, how does it work? What is such a thing which happens when we start utilizing, or we are in position to create a virtual machine? That's what I need to know. Okay, so not a problem. So let us talk about, see, that every individual person within its capability has information about virtualization, right? What we are going to do here is we are going to understand that how does virtualization actually work. So see, let me tell you a small story here. When I was a kid, so I used to go to my school and computer was introduced there. So it was like very initial phase of computer education. So I got to know that there was a complete box, and my teacher told me that this is going to be CPU. There were only 5 components in that computer which I operated. Like there was a keyboard, a mouse, a monitor, a CPU, and a particular UPS. There were only five components for me in that computer. When I got a little big, I grown up, I went to some different institute. So I got to know that the particular CPU box, which was told to me, that was a CPU cabinet only. Actual CPU was something like plate, right? So later on, I got to know, okay, this is CPU. Later on, I got to know this is not CPU, this is not a motherboard. CPU is going to be a single chip on the top of that motherboard. Later on, I got to know that CPU is also having two different parts within itself. One is going to be male chip and second is going to be female chip. Then I got to know that when we talk about virtualization, so there are CPU rings, although CPU is like a square chip, right? But inside that CPU chip, there are some logical rings which are actually responsible in order to provide us the feature of virtualization. Now let me tell you how does it work. So first of all, we have ring zero, and ring zero consists of kernel. So I hope that every one of us is well known to kernel. But like, what is kernel?
It is mediator actually. So if you the system and the physical host and the virtual host want to communicate it with each other, so through the kernel help, so it happen. Yeah.
Can you elaborate a little more? What is kernel?
So something sort of mediator actually.
Mediator between what?
Between physical host and virtual host.
Okay.
Basically, you can say interface or mediator between hardware and software.
Correct. Yes, I mean to say like something like that. Yeah.
Okay. Good. Let me make some rings here first. After that, we are going to discuss about it. I'll bring two more. Because a single CPU has four rings by default. These are known as logical rings of a CPU. So 3, 2, 1, and 0. Yes, these are four rings, right? So this is known as ring zero. And over here, in this particular section, kernel lies. This is known as kernel layer. So within this particular layer, this is for kernel. And this is known as ring zero. Let me type in here. Ring one, this is going to be. So guys, we need to understand this particular thing that whenever we are talking about a particular system, so system consists of some devices and drivers, right? So all the particular ring, like ring one. So this ring one is consisting of some devices and drivers. So guys, do you know what are devices and drivers? Anyone who can answer this particular question? What are devices and drivers?
To run any application, the drivers are used.
Okay.
Yeah, to run the kernels and device driver means related to kernels. Yeah, device driver.
A little more elaboration I'm looking for, if someone can do.
So driver is something like libraries.
Okay, library, good. And why do we use these drivers?
For the interaction.
Interaction of what?
Between components.
Hardware and software. These are basically the dependencies.
Okay. So answers are coming in chunks. Be more specific, please. Eric? Okay. Let us consider this silence as no. So guys, let me tell you here that I have like this video with me, right? I need to play it. So if I double click on this, so it will start playing, right? Let me show you. It is ready to be played, right? If I want, I can play this. And whatever I want, I can get the information out of it.
Again, we need to provide some
right? But what if this, as soon as I double clicked on this particular icon, that it started playing and things started working for me. But if I want to know that how it started playing, so let me go back to my this page. So over here, okay, that was something like which I did not want to have. Okay, not this one even. I was working with some different components of this. Yes, I was working here. Okay, so I was here at application or UI level. Application, or you can call that UI, it means user interface. I went to my screen, I double clicked on that particular button. So by default, there is a default application set for every individual operation, right? So let us say if I like link, if I click on any link, which is like, let us say there is a particular link here, right? If I click on this, then definitely it is going to take me to any browser, because obviously these sort of URLs are accessible via any browser only, right?
Yeah.
Just say yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So when these URLs are accessible via any browser, so if I try to open this, obviously I'm not going to open. If I open this, so open link, if I click here, then it will go to my default browser, whatever default browser I have set. It will go there. Otherwise, if I want to check the options here, when there is an option like known as open with, so which means there are more than one options available. Either I can go with Google Chrome or I can go with Safari. These are the browsers here. And if you see here, this is written like default. What does it mean? That if I click on this particular option here, then this is going to go to default Google option Chrome. Here, because Google Chrome is my default browser. I do not prefer to use Safari. That depends on person to person choice. I like to use Google Chrome, right?
Right.
So over here, if I click here, it is going to go to default operation. And if I want to check that what all options are available, I can go here like open with option, and I can check the available devices and their drivers that which are available, which are capable enough to open this link, right? That sort of thing is here. So when we talk about like this particular layer, it means we have application installed here. And how the kernel is going to provide us the particular options. So options are provided with the help of this, like DND, like devices and drivers. Obviously, like Google Chrome is going to be device for us. Although that is a software, but that is going to be a sort of device using which we are going to open a particular URL here, right? So whenever we are going to click that link, that will check within ring 1 and ring 2. So this is going to be ring 3. Let me type in here ring two, and this is going to be ring three here, like which is going to be application layer. This is ring three. So end of the day, we need to understand that a CPU has four virtual rings here, like ring zero, where kernel lies, ring one, where devices and drivers. And in fact, these two rings of CPU are consumed by devices and their drivers only, right? Ring three is meant for application where we can execute any application, or you can call that UI, it means user interface. So when we are talking about like we have to play a song, we have to open a browser, we have to perform anything. So sometimes you might have seen that even when you are trying to open a browser, that browser is not accessible. Right?
Yeah.
That browser is not accessible. And why it is so? So guys, keep this thing in mind when we are talking about this particular component, this particular UI thing. So how the application is going to work here? Whenever we will select a particular action to be performed, let us see here. So if I try to open this, obviously it is going to tell me that what all options are available here. Like we have default action player. We can open this particular link with books as well. We can go to App Store, or if you want, so you can figure out any online player as well, online tool as well, in order to access it. So what all options, what all applications do I have here? So inside Finder, in fact, I can open this particular tool with TV as well. I have like Mac TV application available. So if I want, I can open this type of videos, this type of MP4s within Apple TV as well, right?
Yeah.
So how these options are made available to me? So these options are made available to me from this UI. Obviously, whenever I was trying to execute any operation here, as soon as I went to this particular link, this particular layer, it sent a request to kernel that a user is trying to access this particular operation. Kernel checked with itself, like ring one and ring two, in order to figure out that what are the devices and the like working drivers available for that particular operation. So this is how it started working here. Now, when we are talking about hypervisor, so guys, hypervisor is going to be an application layer for like this particular software is going to be installed in like layer three. So now what is going to happen? As we have like Google Chrome, we have Safari, or maybe we have QuickTime Player, or we have like any other sort of application installed in Ring 3, which is accessible as a UI, like user interface, or like we call that software as application. So same thing like hypervisor is going to be installed here. We will start accessing hypervisor on layer 3. Let us say if we have a hypervisor installed and we are going to right click and we are going to create new machine. So how we are going to create new machine? So hypervisor application will send an instruction to kernel. Kernel will check whether all the devices and required drivers are available. Only after that we are in position to create a virtual machine, right? So this is how a particular kernel works. This is a particular working functionality of kernel. We are going to use this hypervisor as a particular mechanism, or you can call that the particular utility of this hypervisor is it can simulate or emulate. There are two terms, simulation and emulation. There are two words. I'll come on to that part as well. Just hold on for a while. So simulation and emulation are the particular major role which this hypervisor is going to play, right? So this hypervisor is going to like virtualize the resources. Now what resources? So kernel is interacting with hardware. So there is a particular layer, whatever operating system you may use. So that is known as HAL, H-A-L. So in Windows, there is a particular file known as HAL.dll. Guys, have you heard of that particular file?
No.
Anyone from Windows background? Guys, do we have anyone from Windows background? Umesh?
Not so much. Just basic overview.
Upinder?
No.
Okay, let me come on to it. So guys, this is not being part of AWS. Do not get confused with this. I'm just trying to bring clarity that what we are going to learn actually. The particular base, I'm trying to make it clear. Otherwise, once again, I'll go on to like AWS console only after some time. But I would like you to understand that what actual thing you are going to achieve. The particular things which are taking place in background. Let us say you go on this interface and you are ready to create a machine. Let us say how quickly we can create a machine, but we should be able to understand that how the particular step is going to work. Okay. Just a moment, guys. Let me show you that the particular operations which are going to be in backend, I'm going to tell you that what exact things are taking place in background. You should be knowing about it, right? I'll go here. I'll select one image. Just forget it what I'm doing. Just see that a virtual machine can be created with these many easy stuff and you need not to worry about it. You can just go here and your machine is ready. You have created a virtual machine within 30 seconds only. Your machine is ready. But we need to understand that what happened in background as well. In order to, let us say, if you really want to say that you are capable and you are like good enough engineer, you are well aware of that. What are the things going on in background? So these sort of thing you should be knowing about, right? That's what I'm trying to explain you here. So this hypervisor is going to be used in order to virtualize the resources. And guys, what are the resources do we need in order to create a virtual machine? We need CPU, we need RAM, we need network, we need hard disk, right? So these are four major components which we need. And how these resources are virtualized. So right now, the hypervisor is going to create a logical boundary between resources, right? Hypervisor is going to be like used in order to create a like logical boundary between resources. So what is HAL here? HAL means H-A-L, hardware abstraction layer. DLL stands for dynamic link library. So if you might have ever got a chance to work with Windows, so there was a particular error which was very, very frequent, like blue dump. Have you ever seen that particular error, blue dump?
Yes.
So many times.
But you did not get a chance to explore that how does it come. So if your kernel is not capable, or if your kernel is not able to interact with hardware, so at that moment you guys used to say that RAM is not working properly. Maybe the particular RAM got displaced. That sort of excuse we used to give. But what happens here when kernel, operating system kernel is not able to interact with hardware, it could be because of CPU, it could be because of loose slot of RAM, or maybe any other component. So at that moment, we used to see the blue dump. And the particular layer which is making us means as an end user, the particular layer which is responsible to supply our executed command or our requested operation to hardware to be processed. That particular thing takes place at this particular layer, which is known as HAL. It means hardware abstraction layer. DLL means dynamic link library, right? So whether it is Linux or whether it is your Windows, so HAL daemon works every place. So this HAL application, or you can call that HAL layer. So this is going to be responsible to virtualize the resources. Like if you talk about CPU, if you talk about RAM, if you talk about network, or maybe any sort of resource, whatever you think that it will be required in order to run a virtual machine. So that sort of things are virtualized with the help of hypervisor, right? So there are the particular role of hypervisor is going to be very, very critical. Why it is so? Because there are two type of role which hypervisor is playing. And why I'm telling you that? So there is a hypervisor which is known as simulator. Simulator means that you might have seen that when the particular training of pilot goes on, so the very first time pilots are not given the actual plane to fly. They are given some simulators, right? Have you heard that particular thing?
Yes, yes.
So what does simulator mean? So simulator means that you will be given just like the same situation, but that is not going to be real thing. Right?
Yeah.
So simulation means that, let us say if I have a box here, box in the sense like there are different terms being used for your physical host. You can call that a machine. You can call that a host. You can call that a box. And in fact, like in general term, in our local language, when we work in server, we work in data center, people call it dabba as well. So that is really bad thing to say. But yes, like in a local data center, people call like ek naya dabba bana de. So we call that particular a box. We call a server a box as well. But that is just a box for us. Okay. So let us say we have a particular host. Because right now we are aware of host. What is host? Host is a physical machine. So a host is consist of CPU, RAM, hard disk, and network, right? These are the four main major component which we have. So obviously we are not going to say that we have here like we have motherboard, like we have different type of we have North Bridge, we have South Bridge, we have L1, L2, L3 cache here. So obviously we are not going to go into that much depth, we are not going to go for motherboard architecture, how the wiring is going to work, what sort of wire is being used for what, how the current is flowing here, in which particular format, what is going to be speed of that current flow, right? We are not going to go into that much depth here. Because right now we are not studying that part, right? So let us say, well guys, what is the particular distance between two wires on your motherboard? Any idea about? You all are using laptops, right?
Yes.
So what is the particular space difference between two wire in your motherboard?
There is no wire.
No, there is wiring inside your motherboard, if you see.
Okay. So not 1 inch means not more than 1 inch. Yes.
Okay, let me tell you, by default, like the standard motherboards which are coming, like which are like approx 16 inch of like 16 and 13 inch of laptops which you have, so over there like 0.22 nm, like nanometer space is there between two different wires, and this is reducing gradually. Okay, so not a problem. So right now what we are going to do here is we are going to create a virtual machine here, right? We are going to create a virtual machine. So let us say this physical host is consist of, let us say for example that this has maybe 64 CPU, and this has maybe like 128 GB of RAM. This has, let us say, 1 TB of hard drive, and this has a network interface speed of maybe 10 gig. Right? This is the hardware configuration of this physical host. Now in this particular virtual machine, what I'm going to have, obviously, even every single virtual machine which we are going to create, that will require CPU, right? So I'm going to say that I'll have two CPU here. If I talk about RAM, so RAM is going to be maybe 4 GB, right? If I say about like hard disk drive, so like HDD, I can say, so I am going to have hard disk, let us say only 50 GB here, right? And if I talk about network, so I want only like maybe 50 Mbps network speed I want to allocate to this particular system, right? So when there is a scenario when we are going to get all the resources from same physical host, keep this thing in mind. When I want such a system to be created where all the resources are going to be from same physical host, like network, hard disk, RAM, CPU, and virtual machine, in this particular virtual machine, we are going to have all the resources from same physical host. That is known as para virtualization. That is known as para virtualization.
Say that again.
When we are going to have all the resources from same physical host. So what all resources like CPU, RAM, hard disk drive, network, when all the resources are being provided to this virtual machine from the same physical host where this virtual machine is going to be created, that is known as para virtualization.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Now, let us say we are running a data center, and in this particular data center, there are so many different components available. Let us say there is a particular rack. So I hope that you all are aware of rack. Right, guys? Yeah. So this is a rack. Yeah. Inside this rack, there are multiple servers. Like this is first, second, third, and like so on and so forth. So we might have like multiple servers here. So these servers are going to be used for storage purpose, right? And these sort of, like this is one additional rack.
Rack means chassis.
Yes, chassis, you can call that.
Okay.
Okay. So over here, like we are going to have this machine we have, and like we have another machine here. We have another machine here. So these over here, we are going to install some hypervisors, right? Like this. And like if I select all the components and if we replicate it here, yes. So these are different boxes here, right? And on the top of these boxes, I had a particular server which is known as RevM. Like Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization Manager. So what we are going to do here is, we will be creating a particular virtual machine at this particular place, and this particular Red Hat Virtualization Manager, or maybe like it could be VMware Virtualization Manager, that is going to be that will be reacting as a manager on the top of all these, like all these physical hosts. These are going to be physical hosts, you can call that. These are going to be like physical boxes, or you can say physical server, right? So the resources which are supposed to be provided, let us say I want to create such a machine where I need to have very, very heavy resources, but in a different combination. So I want to create a machine here. So like I want to create a machine here. Let me create a particular machine so that a virtual machine, I mean to say. I want to create a virtual machine here inside this particular physical host with maybe, let us say, 2 CPU and maybe 16 GB of RAM. That is a different requirement, right? I want to create a separate different machine like on another host here, requirement like 4 CPU and 8 GB of RAM. Over here, I want that network speed should be very, very fast. Maybe I want to have 16 CPU and maybe 32 GB of RAM. I want, but network speed should be up to 100 gig. Right?
So network speed is depend upon fiber, right?
Yes, you are right. I'm just coming to that particular point. So let us say all the servers which are placed in this particular rack or this particular chassis, so these are connected with your fiber optic cable. These are working with Cat 5 or Cat 6 cables. Over here, network speed going to be less. The particular server which you are going to create under this particular chassis, or you can call that this particular rack. So these servers are connected with like fiber optic cable. These are going to be provide a lot of speed, like lightning speed you are going to get in order to transfer your data from one server to another, right? But if you see that over here, you are going to get CPU, you are going to get memory, you are going to get even network speed from the same physical host where you are going to create the virtual machine. But in this particular case, you are going to get the particular storage from a separate server. Like, let us say if you want to have a disk of maybe like 200 GB, so that disk will be created here. So only storage will be provided from a separate server to you guys. If you have this sort of mechanism enabled, it means, let us say if this particular machine goes down, your data is still there. What you will do? You will just reboot your machine and your machine will be shifted from one physical machine to another physical machine. Reason being, the data is still available on the same physical server where from it was accessible. So that is known as SAN storage, like storage area network. Like a different server is dedicated for you in order to provide you storage. So that sort of that sort of virtualization is known as HVM. It means hardware assisted virtualization. So right now, this hardware is assisting virtualization and you are getting storage from a separate server. So that sort of component is known as HVM. Why I explain to each and everything? Because if you see this particular thing here, so it is like writing here, like Xen hypervisor here and Nitro hypervisor. So if you talk about very high speed performance, very high speed computing, like HPC known as high performance computing. So HPC supported by Nitro hypervisor here. This is a Nitro hypervisor here. Like all the particular latest machines are coming with that sort of technology. But if you talk about Xen, so Xen was working obviously in the same sort of mechanism, but there are three type of virtualization available as of today. First one is going to be like para virtualization. And second one is going to be HVM, it means hardware assisted virtualization. Let me show you that how do we do that. So guys, the machine was created within 30 seconds, but we need to understand that how the machine is created. So like CPU, RAM and network is provided from the same physical host, but the particular disk is provided from a different physical host, right?
Okay.
Are we clear with this or do we have any questions so far here?
Sir, please elaborate more on fiber. I didn't know actually, that's why I want to.
Okay. Please. So like when we are talking about like data transfer, so data transfer comes with a how do we transfer data, whether with wired manner or without wire, right? So let us say I'm speaking from here. I have no LAN card connected with my laptop and you guys are able to listen to me properly, right?
Right, sir.
In loud and clear manner. Okay. So how does it happen? So when we are talking about this particular component, that how does it happen, guys? So this is happening while we are transferring data from one endpoint to another endpoint, from one host to another host, or maybe you can call that from one device to another device. So for transferring data, we need a particular accurate speed, that what is the maximum speed which we can get for data transfer. So if it is being wired, so there are different type of wire do we have?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So when we are talking about DevOps, when we are talking about this particular like data transfer component, so over here, if we have Cat 4 cable, like category 4, category 5, category 6. So Cat 6 support up to like 10 Gbps data transfer. Or maybe 1 GB data transfer. That depends on the particular network interface card which is connected with your physical device. Right?
Okay.
So, okay, let us take one real world example. You have a car, right? The meter in that car is given, like you can run that particular car up to 320 kilometers per hour, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the roads are not supporting. There are a lot of bumps into the roads. What you will do? You will obviously try to run fast, but definitely in controlled manner. And when you are running in controlled manner, it means you are not going up to very maximum speed. Same way, let us say the network interface card, which is connected in your server. So that is going to provide you up to 1 terabyte of data transfer speed per second. But the particular carrier, this cable, if we talk about, this cable does not allow to transfer data for more than 100 gig. So in case of fiber optic, that fiber optic means the data is going to travel with the speed of light. It means a lot of data you can transfer.
Right.
So not only network interface card is going to be responsible for your data transfer.
Okay.
But your particular carrier as well. Carrier in the sense of particular cable which you are going to use. So that will also be responsible to contribute its utility while transferring data from one place to another. That is how it is going to work. Second thing, let us say you have fiber optic cable. It means you have now Mercedes, you have maybe Hummer, you have maybe Porsche, the world supercar you have, but roads are not good. Or let us say now if you have world's best car to run, let us take other example. Let us say now you have a particular world-class road. Like you can talk about Yamuna Expressway here in Noida, right? Or maybe like Agra Expressway, whatever the Taj Expressway, you can talk about from Agra to Lucknow, right? So you have that expressway, but you are going with your Maruti Alto or maybe Nano. So what do you think? What is going to be maximum speed of that car?
Yes, so 80 to in between 80, yes.
80 to 100 maximum Nano?
Yes.
If you talk about Alto, so maximum 130?
Yes.
And even chances are there that the particular kidney will fail of that car.
Maybe
the kidneys will be damaged if you run that car for 130 kilometer per hour, maybe for like 30 minutes only, right?
Right.
The car will meet with maybe heart attack, right? So it's right. Say what I mean to say here is, so both the things are going to be responsible here. The particular network interface card associated, it means the particular type of car you have. Moreover, the carrier, the particular road I'm talking about. So fiber optic is going to provide you a lot of network speed, network data transfer speed, and the particular physical server which you have. So it means that is your BMW.
Correct.
Right. So that is how we can take this example. Data storage is taking place on a separate device. Like CPU, RAM, network speed is going to be provided to you from a separate device. And this is how the particular complete data center is working inside AWS.
So this is how the means exact scenario in data center as well?
Yes.
Okay. Got it.
That is exact scenario. So let us say if we want to have like combination of CPU and RAM, like 1/2, then we can have any normal server. 1/4 if we want to have here, let us say if we want to have like 2 CPU and 4 GB of 8 GB of RAM, so 1/4 ratio is there. If we want to have something else, let us say if we want to have 2/16. Right, 2/16, if we want to have different type of machines are going to be there. So like based on a requirement, different type of machines will be provided. And if we are going to select this sort of ratio, so this particular Red Hat virtualization manager is going to select a physical server where the particular RAM is allocated in this particular segment only, in this particular format only. Because see, whenever you are going to select a particular virtual machine, so you will have to understand this Red Hat virtualization manager, or maybe you can call that like a VMware manager is going to allocate that particular machine, the particular virtual machine which you are going to create, that will be created on such a host where combination here is, let us say we have only 128 CPU and let us say we have 1 terabyte of RAM. Right? So the particular physical servers which are associated, which are kept in data center. So based on the particular criteria, these sort of like mechanisms are going to work. Right, guys?
Yeah, right.
Okay. So now let us talk about, I hope that I'm clear with this, that what sort of virtualization do we have? What is para-virtualization? What is hardware-assisted virtualization do we have? How does virtualization work? What are the like logical rings of a CPU? What is kernel? What is hal.dll? How does it happen that we are going to create a virtual machine and that is going to provide us the resources? So there was two words left, like simulator and emulator.
Now, I have a question here.
Please, feel free.
Like when we are talking about these rings, that we have zero as a kernel and ring three as an application. So when we are interacting with application, it goes back and forth to communicate through kernel. And then kernel checks with these devices and drivers that we have. But as we can see that in ring one and ring two, these are like drivers, devices and drivers. So why do we have two rings for the same purpose? Like, is there any specific reason for that?
Yes, there are specific reasons for that. So what happens, let us say there are like different type of applications we run. So some applications are like version specific. Let us say there is an application which will run only on 64 bit of hardware. Some applications will run on only on 32 bit hardware. But there are some applications which come with no architecture, whether being 64 or whether being 32. So it is auto compiled at the time of installation. That is why there are two separate rings for that.
Okay.
So you might have seen, so even like some RPM comes with no ARC. Like no architecture, that is not architecture independent. So whenever you will start installing that RPM or maybe that sort of software, so that will be recompiled at the time of installation itself. So whether it is going to be 32 bit, 64 bit, or what sort of hardware you are going to have, so that will recompile itself in order to be installed. So that is why we have to do separate rings for devices and drivers.
Okay, thank you.
Right, guys?
Yeah.
Am I clear on that, guys? Upender, Umesh?
That's clear.
Deeper.
Yeah, clear.
Guys, please tell me, because see, the particular thing which I'm telling, these are really, really critical. And this is really deep knowledge, which even those guys who are working on virtualization for several years, they do not understand this concept.
Right.
Why I am trying to tell you guys, even you can talk about to those guys who are working on VMware, they are not aware of this thing.
Yes, sure. Correct.
Yeah, this seems a little bit deeper.
So far I have not found anything deeper than this.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It looks a little bit deeper. So now I was looking at, you see the rack and the Red Hat VMs, right? So basically what you're saying is can you go up a little bit with it? Yeah, so we got what, 16 by 32 and 100 100G for. So that is a fiber optics cable coming from the rack, right? So the rack is going to be your physical environment. Am I getting that right?
Yes, you are getting it right. So what does rack means? Like rack is going to be like sort of Almira, you can call that, or you can call that a shelf where you are going to place multiple servers.
Right. So everything
like
on the left side.
Like the particular data center establishment begins from like server mounting means like you are going to set a server. There will be some sort of like holes are going to be there where you are going to like tie it with some help of some screw, maybe some nuts and bolts, right?
Right.
Because server should not be movable.
You're right. I get that. So will I be right to say so these are your virtual machines and then these are your hosts, right? Which is your service, right? On the rack.
So shall we move ahead, guys?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, just tell me, guys. So am I going really into deep or shall I be telling only overview things?
No, that's fine. I mean,
no, sir. It's a very learnable things from
here. Because guys, see, there are two things. First of all, there is a word known as motivation. And second thing here is known as like to implement that thing in real world. So motivation is just a starting point. Motivation can be a starting factor only for anything. But when we want to achieve the goal, so we have to be practicing that thing again and again. And when we are practicing, so practicing should be converted into habit.
Give the strength by motivation. Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
and habit has different steps to be cultivated. Like we can cultivate any habit. So guys, do you know that how long does it take to like make any, like how long do we need to practice any work to make it as a habit?
21 days.
Huh?
Yeah, I'm trying.
21 days.
Practicing every day.
Actually, if you work anything for 8 weeks in a regular manner, only then it is considered to be a habit. If the wow. particular person starts working, keeps on repeating tasks for 21 days, then 80% chances are there that the particular habit will be no longer exist in future.
Yeah, after 21 days. Yeah.
21 days, definitely you will be into practice. You would start working on that. You will not feel hard in order to like start the work. But if you practice it for 60 days, maybe you can call it 8 weeks, right? Then it is considered to be a habit.
Okay, means that the work will be in the back mind.
Like you will start craving for that. That if you do not do anything, the particular thing which you have been doing for last 60 days, and if you do not do it today, then you will start craving. Like just like smoking, like drinking, like going to gym, like running. Right? So that sort of
it become like, a habit.
Maybe
yeah.
like as I do have the same feeling for studies. I do not yes. fall asleep if I am not studying, then I do not fall asleep.
That's great.
That is a habit. Okay.
Wow.
So one more thing, guys, I was trying to tell you, every single habit has to be rewarding. Why I'm telling you, because guys, see, if I'm teaching and you are practicing, that is just a regular routine, right? But that has to be habit. Every single day, whatever you practice, that has to be rewarding. Break your task into multiple small chunks. Let us say that if you are going to complete this exercise today, then you will go for a, like maybe you will eat that particular, like your favorite thing. Or if you do not complete it today, there has to be a punishment. Like let us say you do not like to go to market, right? But you would like to go to your nearby shop. If you complete this exercise today, you will go to a nearby shop and you will have your like favorite candy, whatever you like, right? But if you do not complete it today, you will have to go to market. There should be a punishment as well for that. If your task, whatever you are performing, if that is rewarding, so that will keep on motivating you every single day. And the particular task, whatever you are going to set as a goal, that should not be that much big that is really hard to achieve on daily basis. Only then you can cultivate the habit. I have read approximately 15 different books for cultivating habits.
I agree.
Oh.
So even reading is a habit. And even I read multiple books to cultivate this habit. And when this habit is cultivated, so I wrote I read so many other books as well. Okay, guys, so let us go through this AWS console once. Right. So now we are going to begin with this particular. This is AWS console home. This is AWS console home. If you just hover your mouse here, so definitely like you will see somewhere written here like AWS console. This is known as console home. Right, guys. All the services which are provided from the side of AWS, if you click here, then you will be able to see the particular dashboard of services. Like all services are written here. This is a particular search box here. Right. This is a particular search box here. You can type in anything and AWS will bring it for you. Like EC2. So that is here, right? Moreover, if you want to like see the segregation, so like I have already like walked you through this particular section, like what all categories are there. Now, if you talk about that, this is going to be a search box for you for sure. Like you can search anything over here. This is a particular component known as Cloud Shell. We shall be exploring this going forward. Like if you want to manage your particular component, your stuff with AWS CLI, then earlier there was a requirement to set up additional CLI in order to run commands, right? Earlier, there was a requirement that you guys were supposed to set up one additional command line interface in order to run sort of commands here. But right now AWS has provided you this inbuilt feature. that even on your browser, you can initiate your AWS command line tools and you can start running the commands from here only. Let us say if you have to create EC2 machine, there is no need to log into this. Like there is no need to click multiple times here. If you have one like one predefined set of command, you can execute here. If you know what AMI you are going to use, you know the particular hardware type and everything, then you can easily create the machine from CLI as well. Maybe for example, like if every day early in the morning, 9 a.m. you need to create a machine. So you can automate that with the help of any command line tool. You can run it as a cron. As and when it will be 9 a.m. based on your time zone specified, machine will be created for you with the help of the CLI. CLI means command line interface. Yeah, right?
So this CLI is Linux?
Yes, sort of.
Sort of.
Like so preparing your terminal means Linux.
But earlier I was to log into AWS. There is not an option. So it's a new option.
This particular feature is introduced before approx like 2.5 weeks.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't see it.
Yeah.
I think Google GCP was having this. I mean.
Yes, they have copied it from Google only. But this interface is really yuck. I don't like it. Okay. Well, I must not say that thing because see, even like I'm working with this and
so
like,
what if we have multiple servers and we can start this CLI, so how it gonna be means sync means actually it is related to our created server or means it's separate CLI?
So like you can manage your entire AWS account with the CLI.
Oh, so all the access and all
ways to do it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Once you will go through this particular course, you will get to know like what ways are there, what all different options are there. So let us say when I was taking an interview of a person yesterday, so I asked that particular person a question that I want so and so. The person said that we can write a Python script. We can write a particular shell script. We can schedule a cron job on Linux server. When different options are available on the platform of AWS itself, then why there is a need to write additional script? People did not explore AWS. And they are giving such answers that they will write Python script on that. When options are given, why don't you explore that?
Python script on AWS?
Yes, they were saying that we will write Boto3 like script in order to manage servers. When even timers are there, schedule offering is there, everything is given. Why don't you explore? But they were telling me such sort of answer that we will write Python script. Okay. That's why they did not go into second round. Okay, so guys, this is my account. This is my AWS account ID. This is my organization, my service quotas. That if someone is going to ask you that how many servers can you create in your AWS account, so you can check your service quota limit here, right? But yes, this quota limit can be increased with the help of like what type of resources you can create. So right now, total quota for EC2 machine for my account, that is going to be 94. How many VPC can I create? That is going to be 23. How many like EBS volumes can I create here? Like Elastic Block, it's 30, that is going to be 37. KMS 52, DynamoDB 9, Athena 4, CloudFormation 24, AWS Lambda 22. And these sort of like different quotas are there, right?
So these quotas are basically per month basis or like in total?
I'm sorry, dear. Like your voice is not audible. Can you please be a little louder?
So these quotas are basically per month basis, or is it in total?
So these are in total.
Okay.
But yes, if you want, you can raise a service request to AWS, and definitely these quotas can be revised. Why does AWS does not provide you a lot of quota here? Let us say that you are practicing. They and obviously, like I'm going to tell you a couple of other things as well here. So let us say you are working with your AWS account, and obviously like for practicing, you guys will have to create your own AWS account. I'm not going to share my account with you. Why it is so? If you're on account, you will handle it with care. Why it is so? AWS provides you free tier account, and multiple services are covered under free tier account. But if it is not yours, so what you will do, you will create services and you will easily forget it, that let it be.
Yeah.
Because I'm not going to pay for it. You will take it like easy going thing, right? But when you will know it well that if you do not terminate the resources, you will have to pay for it. then before even leaving the session, you will try to delete the resources right then, right there, in order to save your money.
You are so right?
So in order to restrict you, because see, currently how many reasons do we have here? I'm going to talk about that particular part as well. So let us say we have approximately 25 reasons available as of today. We have 25 reasons. What reason is, I'm going to tell you, right? So approximately 25 reasons we have here in AWS. So that is why up to 23 to 37, so different number of options are given here, right? So this is quota. You can raise a service request to AWS. How you are going to do that? You will go to service center. You will go to support center, right? You will create a case. So support tickets are known as case here. Support case, right? You will hit here like service limit increase. You will define here like service. Maybe you can go for EC2, right? Like what sort of EC2 do you want to go for? Maybe EC2 instance you are talking about. Now we are like, what you are going to do here is, you will select a region, maybe Cape Town. Like you will select a particular search, what type of instance you are looking for, right? Then after new limit is going to be maybe 1000. You can add multiple requests in the same service ticket. You can define a particular P type instances. You can define your like value here, whatever value you want. Then after AWS will like give you some assistance that on-demand instances are going to be based on like this and that. Then after tell about your use case, why do you want to have these many servers? There are two options, phone and web. AWS team is going to call you right then, right away. Right? And this limit, the service quota will be revised for you, right?
Okay.
So one more thing, guys, I will tell you. So many guys, they usually suffer with their bills. That is the very first thing which I'm going to tell you. I am not going to start the particular case, the particular option till the time you guys know it well, right? So what is going to happen here, guys? So right now, if you see here that I am supposed to pay 55.26 rupees this time. And why it is so? Because the particular options, why I'm going to pay this much, that the particular bill is generated in my account. So this account, this bill was generated because of Route 53. I did some practicals with Route 53, even those practicals which were paid. Route 53 is a free service, but up to some extent, if you like start increasing the service like beyond limits, you will have to pay for it. So like on this particular dashboard link where you are going to go for, you will go to this particular your account page. You will go into your like my billing dashboard. You will be landed here, right? Then after you will be able to figure out that the particular bill which you are supposed to pay this month, then why you are supposed to pay that. You will understand that, okay, this is going to be Route 53 service. How much you are going to pay for it? Then this is the particular amount which you are supposed to pay. These are the particular taxes, right? This is for RDS. Obviously, I created RDS instance as well for some time only. And for that particular period, I will have to pay this much amount, $0.01.
Mm-hmm.
So you will have to continuously monitor this particular page. Maybe the particular day when you started using your service, the very next day you will have to visit it. Why it is so? If you do not visit, then obviously there is an option like you can raise a wave of request to AWS team. And if it is maybe $10, $20, $50, then chances are there that AWS team can waive it off maybe once or twice within your entire one calendar year. But if it is case that you are just generating bills and you are forgetting it, you have made it BAU, like business as usual, AWS team is not going to waive it off. You will have to pay it.
Oh.
Right, guys? That is why I'm explaining you these sort of things I'm telling you in advance. That there should be no one saying that, boss, we have like a lot of bills in our account and we are going to take loans for it now. Even I have applied loan for this. So that is a jokes apart, guy. But yes, be very, very careful. Be very, very careful in order to be not a particular victim of unwanted bill charges in your account. Right?
Okay.
So whatever resource you are going to create and why you are built, you can check under this particular section. Moreover, if you want to see details, let us say if I want to see that I can go to this particular billing section. If I want to see that why I'm just charged here, I can go here, I can explore this. So in US East North Virginia. There was a backup storage. So like there is a particular storage allocation fees which occurred in my account. That is why I had to pay this much. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Then after, if I talk about Route 53, so what, why I paid this? So this is going to be Route 53, a global service. And like why I had to pay for it. So like Amazon Route 53, the DNS queries. So there was a particular domain. So I had a particular Amazon Route 53 health check non-AWS, right? So I did some health check from AWS. I had some health check created on AWS. So for which I had to pay this much. And moreover, like Amazon Route 53 hosted zone. So I hosted my domain on AWS for a single month. Like if it is under 24 hours, AWS does not charge you anything. But if it is beyond one day, then you will have to pay for it for 1 month. And the standard charges are $0.50. Even if you try to see the particular EC2 machine here, so you can check it here that why and like, okay, I created a machine here in US East North Virginia. So what type of machine did I create here? So I created a T2 medium machine for like, for these many minutes. So that is why I had to pay this much charges. And moreover, I used some sort of like storage as well, like 0.5 GB. Like in North Virginia, I have some of the volumes available. That is why I had to pay for this month, right? So now based on this particular bill, what I'll do here is, okay, now you got a particular idea that how you are going to like elaborate your bills, right? Now, based on this particular thing, you will go and you will check. I'm just telling you at the very first end, do not think that what sort of things are going to be there. I'm going to see that the particular load balancer here, right? This snapshot is created and I'm paying for it. I created this snapshot last night. Right, guys? So what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to see my load balancer. I'll terminate it. Whatever resources I created, I will terminate these resources in order to save cost. Obviously, like it was late night. I was working with this. I was just taking something. I was onto something, so that's why I did not delete it. So, okay, what I'll do here is I will delete each and everything because see guys, if you feel that you will have to create it again, then you are going to be in loss. Why it is so? Number of times you are going to create resources, you will do more and more practice here, right?
Yeah.
This account is going to be for your practice account. So delete resources as many times as you can, right? Even auto scaling group, you can think of. Whatever resources you have in your account, delete them. Moreover, like if you have a particular thing, which you like a snapshot you have, so you can delete your snapshot as well. How we are going to figure out that what are the resources do we have in our account? I'm going to tell you right away. Okay, so we have a snapshot here. I'm going to delete that. Don't worry, you will be able to figure out the things that where to go and how to go. Because I have been performing this sort of
thing. Is there any way to get all the resources which I have created?
Yes. There is a way. Okay. So guys, I hope that we are clear till this particular time. Till this particular place like Blink Dashboard. If you want to change your security credential, like you want to change your password, you feel that someone or the other has seen your password. Someone was like peeping into your screen. And now you are trying to just change your password. So obviously you can click here to change your password, right? MFA, it means multi-factor authentication. After providing your password, you will have to provide one like secret code as well. We will discuss during time of your, that particular, what should I say? Like when we will study this IAM, like Identity Access Management Policy, we will discuss. So at that moment, we gonna definitely discuss about it, right? So if you want to check about your access ID secret key, what are these? Why do we use it? Everything we will discuss like cloud. We can modify CloudFront key pairs here. We can go to EC2 console from here directly. Like we have X509 certificates in order to like your own certificate you can upload. You can create your new certificate here. So that sort of thing are there, right? In fact, your account identifier. So like whenever you are going to ask some other account holder to provide you permission in your account. So guys, keep this thing in mind. You are not going to share your account ID there. You are going to provide your canonical user ID. you are going to provide your canonical user ID. This is just like C name as we have in DNS. So same sort of like this is canonical user ID. So this ID you will share with others in order to get access, right?
Right.
Because this is going to be canonical user ID. This is AWS ID. This is canonical user ID. So both are going to remain same end of the day. Okay. Now, guys, AWS has two sort of things here. Let me tell you. Let me go to once again. So AWS has two sort of services. One is regional and second one is global. So guys, I hope that we all are aware of that. What is regional? What is global? So let us say when I'm going to select a region. So first of all, I need to have one particular very clear picture in my mind that why am I going to create resources here? Okay, let us say someone is going to say that I am going to have a business in India. So obviously my preferred region is going to be Mumbai. And what is region? Region is a geographical area. Region is going to be a particular geographical area where AWS has created multiple data centers.
Right?
Let me come onto this particular diagram once again. Let me select everything here and I'm going to delete it. Okay. So let us say this is Amazon data center, right? This is globe. Right now we are going to have here, like this is Mumbai. Right? And let us type in here Mumbai. We have, maybe this is North Virginia. We can type in here NV only. This is city, Cape Town, right? Let us say this is CF, California. We can have one more here, maybe Sydney, right? So if you are going to talk about these sort of different geographical regions here, right? So if these are known as regions like North Virginia, Ohio, California, Oregon, Cape Town, Hong Kong, Mumbai, Seoul, Singapore, Sydney, Tokyo, like Central Canada, right? Frankfurt, Europe, and even in Middle East, we have Bahrain, South America, we have Sao Paulo and Stockholm in Europe, Paris, Milan, right? So these sort of like different geographical regions are there, right? So if we are talking about a different geographical region, different geographical area, a part of country, so that is known as region. But let us say if we talk about Mumbai, so Mumbai is going to be a particular region, but inside Mumbai AWS has created multiple data centers. So this is our first data center, that is known as data center is also known as availability zone. AZ, which is known as availability zone, right? So this is AZ1. Let us say this is in Mumbai, right? And we have another data center. Maybe that is going to be in HYD. Any location you can think of it, because AWS is not going to disclose that particular, right? So third data center here is going to be maybe in Delhi. I don't know where it is. Because see, I have nothing to do with AWS resources. I know only one thing, that AWS has three different availability zones which are isolated from one another. And these are created on separate isolated geographical area. Right, guys? So this particular area is known as region. The Mumbai is known as region. And the data centers which are created in Mumbai region, these are known as availability zone. Are we clear with this particular thing?
Yes.
Are we clear with region and availability zones?
Yes. Yeah. So in Mumbai region, there is only two, it means right now, correct? No? Two AZs?
What's your name? Rahul?
Yes, Rahul actually, yeah.
Oh, great. हाथ कंगन को आरसी का पढ़े लिखे को फारसी का देख लेते हैं तीन है इसको तो एक साल से ऊपर हो गया भाई इट्स बीन मोर देन अ ईयर दैट मुंबई हैज स्टार्टेड ऑपरेटिंग विद थ्री डिफरेंट अवेलेबिलिटी ज़ोन्स इट्स बीन मोर देन अ ईयर
ओके
इवन आई मस्ट से मोर देन ईयर एंड हाफ नाउ
Yeah, correct, correct. Sorry.
Not a problem. Completely fine.
Yeah.
So, okay, guys. So, are we now aware of that what is availability zone and what is reason?
Yes.
I did not hear you guys.
I'm good with that.
Oh, great. That's fine. So, now, one more thing is here. So, AWS is going to provide these services in two ways. Either it would be a regional service or it is going to be a global service. Like, as I'm working with S3, this is going to be like in order to operate with this particular like service known as EC2, I will have to select a region first. Let us say if I have to operate in Bahrain, right? Maybe in Stockholm, maybe in Milan. So I will have to select a region first. Maybe in Hong Kong, whatever region you want, you will have to select a region first. But there are some other services as well. Let us say if I talk about Route 53. So Route 53 is going to be a global service. Now, when do I call it a global service? So it means before operating this particular service, I need not to select a region here. Like S3, like Route 53 does not require a region selection. Like even if I click here, that is going to be such sort of feature that I can just only highlight this particular text, nothing else. Because this is going to be a global service. Right?
Mm-hmm.
S3 is going to be a particular global service. Route 53 is a global service. Apart from this, like let us say if you talk about S3, so even S3 is going to be a global service. S3 does not require region selection. Why? It is written global here, right? Moreover, you can think of IAM. Where is that? Here it is. So even you can think of IAM, that is going to be global service. So guys, you need to like keep on focusing on this particular part as well, that whenever you are working with a service, so you need to just throw a light on this particular component, that whether the service which you are utilizing is global or regional service, right? Because during interview, I completely agree with that particular question does actually not make a sense, that whether it is a global or local service. But just to check here, that how aware you are with the services, how keen you are to know about the services, how actively you perform with the services, whatever you are performing. So what all options are before your eyes? Do you actually throw your light on that or not? Right? In order to check the particular your IQ level, right? So they would like to ask these sort of question as well. Okay, tell me one thing, in which region do you create IAM role? They will not ask you it is a global or it is a like regional service. So a person can ask that which region do I need to select before creating IAM user, right? Or let us say a person can throw you a question in this way as well. Let us say I need to host my DNS. So which region do I need to select? Getting point? So they will throw a question to you in such a different way that you will have to think that, yeah, I have never ever selected a region before it. So you should always say that in order to host a domain name or in order to create a user, I need not select a region, because IAM is a global service, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And finally, we have this dashboard here. Like if you want to go for training, documents, forum, like expert help. So these sort of things, you can get it here, right? Okay. So the very final thing for the day is I am going to explain you EC2 dashboard. So guys, this is EC2 dashboard. This is old one actually. AWS is in transition mode. They are migrating their EC2 from old to new console. So new console is going to look like this. AWS EC2 console is going to look like this. One more thing is here. AWS has started promoting its own product onto its platform. See, how does it make sense that you can easily size, configure, and deploy Microsoft SQL Server always on availability groups in AWS using the AWS Launch Wizard for SQL Server? How does it make sense? I don't want to use Microsoft SQL. But they are promoting that they have some components. On previous particular page, that sort of ads did not used to come before. But right now, yes, AWS has started promoting this sort of thing, and we will have to be ready for it. right? So all the number of running instances, you can see it here. This particular thing is going to be very, very helpful for you guys in order to save your cost, right? So like how many total running instances you have, but in this region only. See guys, what is written here?
Mumbai,
right? So this particular dashboard is going to show the resources in Mumbai region only. So guys, this is my suggestion for you. Whenever you will start operating, you will be in learning mode. So do not try to select multiple regions here. Like today I'm working with Singapore, tomorrow I will work with Hong Kong, and next day with Cape Town, next day with Oregon, next day with North California, then North Virginia. No, I'll suggest to go with only two regions, whatsoever the regions are going to be. So my recommendation here is first region is North Virginia or Oregon. You can pick anyone out of these two. And second reason you can pick as Mumbai. Why it is so? Because all the latest features, whatever AWS introduces. So the regions here are East, US East, it means North Virginia or Oregon. These are the two major regions where AWS starts launching new features. Right, guys? Second thing, if you want to do regular practice, then you can go to Mumbai region.
Okay.
Right? But do not opt any other region here. Why it is so? Let us say, if you create instances and you forget, you will have to pay for it. And when you will have a habit here, you will have a complete practice, you will make it a habit that you are going to create resources in only two regions, either North Virginia or Mumbai. Then in that case, that you can quickly check, you can quickly do a recap that what are the resources running here, right? Otherwise, as of today, more than 20 regions are available on this platform. So it is going to be really, really critical for you to check all the 20 regions for all the resources, whatever you have created. So, or if you really want to go through it, then you can go to billing section and you can explore it there as well, right?
Okay, there's I just want to ask, is there any way to that we can check it globally, what all instances are running for our account? Is there any way on a single page we can see? Instead of going on in different regions?
Yes, billing dashboard is the only way.
Okay.
Billing dashboard is the only way right now. Earlier there used to be resource group, but actually that was not that convenient.
So, sir, so for S3, you told this is a global service. So,
yes.
So for this, we also need to select one region, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, why do you say it's a global? So,
S3 is global because you will get a particular URL in order to access that particular S3 bucket.
Okay. So we need a region.
The particular data center which you opt, let us say you are running your data center in Cape Town, you have created your resources in Cape Town. So it is not recommended to create your S3 bucket in Milan.
Mm-hmm.
Because every time you will upload a single file from Africa, maybe from Cape Town to Milan. So at that moment, definitely you are going to be paying some more charges here. So that is why, though that is going to be a global service, because that can be accessible from entire world, wherever internet is accessible. You can access your S3 bucket from that particular point, but you are given that option as well. You are completely free that whatever region you want, you can select. Being a global service, though, even you can select a region based on your resources creation. Because there are different use cases, right?
Yeah.
We will discuss about that in detail. So guys, you can see all the running instances here. Moreover, you can see your dedicated host. So even you can have your physical servers in AWS data center. Moreover, you can have number of volumes. Now, what is volume? Hard disk drive, HDD, which is known as, you can see that here, that how many volumes you have. So there is a particular use case. You see that there is no running instance, but there are two volumes. What can be use case here? So it could be possible that you created two instances and now you stopped the resources. You stopped the instances. I'll repeat it again. You created two instances. Instances were running. You are not using them. You stopped them. Right? But you are able to see two volumes here. Number of zero will be two in that particular case. So which means that right now two volumes are created in your account and you are paying for it.
So in this case, even if we terminate the instance, so volumes will be reflecting or not?
No. If you terminate, then volume will go away.
Okay.
So these are going to be key pairs. What key pairs are, we will discuss later on, and placement group will be discussed later on. Key pair, okay, in a nutshell, if I want, I can tell you that whenever we create an instance, so by default, we do not have a username or password for that, right? So in case of Windows, for doing RDP, we get a particular password with the help of this key. In case of Linux, we can do SSH with the help of this key into Linux operating system. Right? In detail, we will discuss tomorrow. Right? But for now, you can think of that this particular key pair is going to be used for two purposes. First of all, it is going to be for like SSH, doing SSH into your EC2 machine in case of Linux. And if you're going to boot a Windows machine, then for sure you are going to be able to do RDP, like remote desktop protocol you can use in order to access your remote, Windows machine, right? Placement group is really such a question which is really asked during interview. In fact, I love to ask this question every time. So placement group is going to be like a set of physical servers where you are going to create your EC2 machines. So these will be lying under same placement group. Placement group means, let us say, if you are going to create like memory optimized instances. So these are going to be kept on same sort of hardware. Like you can call that in same rack. So I hope that you guys remember rack that we were discussing earlier.
Yeah.
Right. So in the same rack, all the servers are going to be created. That is going to be placement group. We will discuss in more detail as well. But for now, you can think of that placement group is going to be a logical unit of your servers, which you are going to create. Logical unit of your virtual machines, which are going to be created on same sort of hardware. Elastic IP is going to be a public IP address, but Elastic IP address has the capability that it can be reassociated with your EC2 machine. Like the particular EC2 machine, which you are going to create. So let us say if you want that particular machine should not be changing public IP address like again and again. By default, whenever you create EC2 machine, so it comes only with one private IP address and one public IP address. Public IP address is optional. If you want, only then AWS will assign, otherwise not. But yes, whenever you will stop that machine, public IP address will be removed from your server, and whenever you will start again, so chances are there you are going to get a new IP address there.
So means if you enable Elastic IP, then it's a static IP, we can say.
Yes, you can call that it is static IP address, but public.
Yeah.
You can call that Elastic IP is static public IP address.
Sometimes we log in onto our own VMware and sometimes the IP is going to change for some instance. So it will stick if you enable.
Yes, but there is a condition, let me tell you today itself, that if you have associated Elastic IP address with EC2 machine, it is free. There is no additional charges for assigning a static IP address with your EC2 machine. But if due to any reason you stopped that machine, you are not using that machine, right? So AWS is going to charge you for having Elastic IP address associated with such a machine which is not in running state.
Oh,
this is just to save the use of public IP addresses. Because like, let us say if you have created 2000 machines and these all are in such a state and you are not using public IP address because it is associated with your machine, you are not utilizing it, but you have blocked other people using it.
Correct.
Snapshot is going to be backup of your EC2 machine. We will discuss in detail how to create, what are the particular characteristics we have and all. Load balancer, as the name suggests, that if we have multiple servers running behind and we want to distribute load among that, we're going to have load balancer, right? Security group is sort of like software configuration, which is going to be treated here as a firewall. Right, guys? So that is it for this EC2 dashboard. Obviously, when tomorrow we will start creating like EC2 machine, then we will go more into depth. So guys, I would like to understand only one thing, any feedback for today's session or not any, actually, I would like to hear from your side that how did you find this class, whether it is informative or like you want something else to be added into class, you want me to go into more deep dive or what, like what are your views on this particular class? Because see, why I'm asking this? You can criticize me. Whatever you want, you can do. I do not mind that particular thing because, see, I'm still looking for like a scope of improvement within myself. Yes, guys, please. It's up to it's on you now.
No, I guess the session was pretty informative and interactive, I guess. So it's good going so far. So far, so good.
Okay. Rahul, your words?
Yeah, it was very good, actually. Yeah, I didn't ever seen deep dive.
Okay, great. Eric, what do you think?
Well, I mean, it's very informative, right? What I kind of think about the whole thing is that, you know, some of the deep dive, you know, comes in different domain, which I don't know if everybody is familiar with, you know, different, you know, like for me, I hate networking for something, right? So when you dive into like the way you broke down the visual machines and the hyperversus and everything, it's like, I just want to know the surface and just go away. You see what I'm saying? But I mean, it's a deep information that is necessary, and I think I'm loving it. That's all I can say.
Great. Thank you for your words, Eric. Thank you for your words.
Yeah.
Darshan, what do you think?
So thank you, sir, for the session.
Okay.
I mean, it's great. I mean, the multidisciplinary approach. I mean, what you take from different subjects. It's really great.
So even that is a particular thing that I would love. I would make Eric love with network.
Because I don't like network.
Whenever we will discuss about VPC, so at that moment I'll explain network part as well, and I will make you love with networking.
Yeah. So for me, I try to go to the security side. You know, basically doing all kinds of IAMs and stuff like that, right? Encryption and stuff. So I like security instead of networking. So okay. Let's see how it goes. Hopefully
that's good. That's good. In fact, let me tell you, security is an illusion.
It's a what?
It's an illusion. Everything is secure till the point you can see it, and everything is insecure beyond that.
Right.
I'm certified ethical hacker as well, right?
Oh. That's one thing I like to do after this, if you got it.
Okay, not a problem. Okay, Deepak, anything you would like to say on this? I hope we do not have Deepak with us. Harsh? Harsh, are you there? Are you with us? I hope people are on mute and they are not listening to us. Not a problem, guys. So, well, thank you so very much, everyone, for being part of this session. And okay, Rashika, ma'am.
So,
any feedback for the session?
It was always amazing. Main hamesha bolti hu, you teach very well, and it was always amazing.
Obviously, because after the session, you are going to take feedback from all the students. So I thought of asking myself.
Great.
Okay, that's fine. That was just like another thing. Upendra sir, any feedback for the session?
So very good session. The way of explaining things was very good.
Okay, thank you. Umesh bhai?
Really, yeah, the way to explain the things is awesome.
Ah, fantastic. Good to hear that.
Yeah.
So, hope to see you tomorrow. So, till then, have a good time. And if you have any other feedback as well, you can directly share with Rashika, ma'am. Because she is the one who is responsible for all these things. She is responsible to take feedback of trainers. Even you can share my feedback with her. And I'll be scolded after that. Okay, guys. Thank you.